Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner, available for code reviews and on-site training. If you're interested in my training and you happen to be in Europe or interested in traveling to Europe and you haven't been able to sort out having me actually on-site to your company up to this point, feel free to check out my C++ Best Practices class that'll be coming up at NDC Tech Town in Kongsberg, Norway in September. Or my Applied Constexpr single day workshop that will be coming up in C++ Under the Sea in Breda, Netherlands in October. Okay, in this episode, I'm going to talk about an object lifetime issue around ranged-based for loops. Now, this is a change in C++ 23 that only Clang at the moment supports. Now, I would like to point out that this work was, I think, mostly done by Nico Iosidis, who speaks at many conferences all over the world. And so this, I know, was a bit of a win for him, something that he had been working on for a while. Now, I'll also go ahead and state that I haven't really tested this yet, but it's supposed to work according to CPP references. Compiler support matrix. So I'm just going to go ahead and build an example and see what happens. As C++ developers, we are honored to contribute to self-driving technology, simplify lives with embedded devices, support financial ecosystems, and assist traders with trading bots. To keep up with the pace of development, we need tools that help us work quickly and effectively. CLion is a powerful JetBrains IDE for C and C++ that makes this challenge its main goal, integrating code analysis, refactoring, and the best ecosystem tools into our day-to-day development. Use CPP Weekly CLion to get 25% off when you purchase a new CLion subscription or renew your existing one. Okay, at the most basic level, this thing is working. We are constructing a thing, we're printing all of its elements, and then the thing is destroyed at the end of main. So lifetime ends there on line 31 in this particular case. Now, I'm going to illustrate the problem. Let's say I have an object that returns a thing. And this is going to be very straightforward. If I change this expression to now say make thing dot get data, then I should have an object lifetime problem here from the way that the rules work in C++ 20 and before. Now, note that I did not get any values printed here. And this is a side effect of the fact that I have an object lifetime problem. So I call make thing. Make thing returns a new temporary thing. I then call get data. Get data returns a reference to this vector inside of thing. Now I have a reference to an object that came from a temporary. And during the evaluation of this ranged for loop, the temporary returned by make thing itself now has its lifetime end. And this is C++ 20 mode, like I said. Now we're going to go ahead and switch this over to GCC. And I have to change this flag. And we'll see if we get significantly different answer from GCC. Here we go. So this is just an aside, we have possibly dangling reference to a temporary. This is GCC's new object lifetime analysis that it's able to do, which is amazing when it works. So GCC is preventing us from doing this thing. Okay, let's go back to Clang. And we are now going to switch to C++ 23 mode. Now, the change that was made in C++ 23 is to extend the lifetime of the temporary in the ranged for loop. So here's hoping it does what it's supposed to do. And it did, in fact, do what it was supposed to do. Except somehow I am not getting this new line printed. Oh. Actually, this is perfect. This new line is not printed here because we can now see that the thing the thing, was destroyed at the end of this for loop. All right, so there you go. That is this change from C++23. For those of you who are interested in this kind of thing, this is P2644R1 and P2718R0, and it talks about the wording here to allow the lifetime extension of things that are in the range for initializer and the ranged for loop. So, and here is a specific example here. This theoretically eliminates an entire class of object lifetime issues that we might have. Now, I'm guessing at least one of you might be curious what happens if we have more than one layer of this. So, well, let's just go ahead and give it a try, shall we? Okay, so now we're going to have outer thing have a function that just returns, what should we have it do? Return a temporary, I guess. Let's do that. Okay, so now we have a function that returns a temporary outer thing, and we're calling on that temporary a function that returns a new temporary thing as well. And then we are calling a function that returns the reference to the thing that was in the temporary from the temporary. So that seems to work, and I believe it's printing things in the correct order from what we would expect. Let's just try one more thing, where now we have a temporary that is returning a reference that is returning a reference, so it needs to go two layers deep with references as opposed to with the temporaries. And that also appears to be doing the right thing, and we will turn on address sanitizer just to verify. Okay, there we have it. Every permutation that I'm able to come up with does do the right thing, the thing that we would hope that it would do, where it extends the lifetime of the thing that's used in our ranged for loop, and again, hopefully eliminating an entire class of potential lifetime issues with ranged for loops. So, thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe.